Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Silent Knit, Deadly Knit by Peggy Ehrhart. Narrated by Callie Beaulieu. Chapter 1. I'm not sure it was a fair trade. Bettina Fraser rested a hand on the graceful pottery vase, a rich shade of blue tinged with violet. All I gave her in exchange was a scarf. It was a beautiful scarf, dear wife. Wilfred Fraser glanced up from the cookie he was decorating. Beautiful and warm and just right for the season. Red with green stripes, Pamela Patterson added. What could be more perfect for Christmas? Pamela was the founder and mainstay of the Arborville, New Jersey Knitting Club, nicknamed Knit and Nibble, and she had watched the scarf take shape over the past several meetings of the group. The cookies that the three friends were decorating were intended to provide the nibble portion of the next meeting. Still, to offer me this gorgeous vase in exchange? Of course, the craft shop is more of a hobby than anything else for Millicent. She certainly doesn't need money. Bettina gave the vase a final caress and picked up a cookie shaped like a wreath. We're running out of green icing, she said, so I might just as well eat this. She bit the cookie in half, sighed with pleasure, and added, Oh, your butter cookie recipe is heavenly, Pamela. With your baking skills, I don't understand how you can be so thin. Bettina was not thin. Pamela was both thin and tall, and her lack of interest in dressing to play up her natural advantages was a source of great puzzlement to her friend. Well, I don't bake every day, Pamela said with a smile, but at Christmas, and with Penny home from college for the break, it's fun to make special goodies, and of course, we need nibbles for the group tomorrow night. She spread yellow icing on a star-shaped cookie and added a sprinkle of yellow sugar. The cookie decorating was taking place at the well-scrubbed pine table in Bettina's spacious kitchen. Woofus, the shelter dog, napped in the corner. Nell won't approve, Bettina said. You know how she feels about sweets. But surely, at Christmas time... Across the table, Wilfred had dabbed the last bit of green icing on a cookie shaped like a Christmas tree and was arranging tiny silver balls to create the effect of a garland. He had tied an apron over the uniform of plaid shirt and bib overalls he adopted when he retired. But Bettina didn't respond. Half to herself, she murmured, I should really call Millicent to ask how she's doing. You just saw her this morning at her shop. Pamela said. Yes, Bettina replied. I did, but something had happened to upset her, and she didn't have time to tell me much. Her partner had just come in, and she had to go over some shop business with her, but then she was going to run out on an errand. She'd already wrapped my scarf around her neck. See, Wilfred cut in. That shows you how much she liked it. Was she upset about something that happened at the shop? Pamela asked. Bettina nodded. Someone, a man, I think, wanted the shop to carry his work. Millicent turned him down, and apparently he became quite angry. She reached for another undecorated wreath and bit into it. It's okay, Pamela said. We have plenty for tomorrow night. Two large platters held cookie stars, reindeer, Santas, wreaths, and Christmas trees, carefully spread with icing in bright shades and garnished with silver balls, sprinkles, and colored sugar. I'll call her right now while I'm thinking of it. Bettina dusted cookie crumbs from her fingers. My phone's in the living room, she added, and rose from her chair. Bettina had barely reached the kitchen doorway when from the living room came the jingle-jangle of her phone. Wolfish jumped up in alarm. It's okay, Wilfred said soothingly, turning toward the huge, shaggy beast who was cringing against the wall. It's just the phone. Then they heard a voice. It resembled Bettina's voice, but it quavered and then modulated into an urgent squeak. Yes, yes, the voice said. She's right here. We're all right here. Bettina appeared in the doorway, her face tightened by fear and her eyes wide. It's Penny, she said, holding out the phone. She tried your phone, but you didn't answer. It's at home, Pamela said. But at that moment, the whereabouts of her phone was the last thing on her mind. Pamela reached for the phone and the words rushed out. Penny, what is it? What's happened? Wilfred rose from his chair, bounded across the kitchen, and pulled Bettina into a comforting embrace. Her head nestled against his chest, her scarlet hair vivid against the faded denim of his coveralls. Looking around nervously, Wolfus loped toward the dining room. Mom? Penny's voice sounded small and far away. I'm down here at the nature preserve. The nature preserve occupied the westernmost edge of Arborville, beyond busy County Road at the bottom of Orchard Street, where Pamela and the Frasers lived. Penny went on. I found a body, Mom. Someone is dead. Penny stopped, and it sounded like she was fighting back a sob. I called the police. We'll be there, Pamela said, feeling breathless. We're coming, right now. She handed the phone back to Bettina. Someone is dead, in the nature preserve. Bettina lifted her head from Wilfred's chest to nod. She told me. Of course. Otherwise, why would Bettina have looked so stricken? Pamela took a deep breath and added, Penny called the police. A siren underscored her statement, beginning as a thin whine, rising to a peak, falling off, and rising again. In a whirl of activity, Pamela and Wilfred grabbed their jackets and Bettina her coat, and they all hurried for the door. Wilfred's Mercedes, ancient but lovingly cared for, waited in the driveway next to Bettina's solid Toyota Corolla. I'll drive, dear ladies, Wilfred said, and helped his passengers into his car. The police had already reached the nature preserve when Wilfred steered the Mercedes into the small clearing that served as a parking lot. A black and white car marked with the Arborville police logo stood empty at the head of a trail. The trail twisted among the dark trunks of the bare trees, their branches sketching complicated patterns against the gray sky. Pamela thrust the car door open before Wilfred had even turned off the engine. She launched herself down the trail, stumbling a bit on the thick layer of fallen leaves. Through the gaps between the trees, she could see the crime scene up ahead. Penny's violet jacket, a recent thrift store find, stood out against the wintry tones of the landscape and contrasted with the subdued uniforms of the two police officers. Penny caught sight of Pamela when she was about 50 feet away and started to run toward her, but was stopped by one of the police officers. The officer turned, and Pamela recognized the young, gentle-voiced man who she'd most recently seen directing traffic at Arborville's main intersection on a morning when the traffic light inexplicably stopped functioning. The other officer was kneeling next to a bundled form that Pamela realized with a shock was the body. Mom! Penny called. From some distance behind Pamela on the trail, Wilfred's voice replied, We're here too. In a minute, Pamela was standing next to her daughter. Penny's eyes were bright and her cheeks were rosy, and under other circumstances, the effect would have been of a pretty young woman whose face showed the effects of a brisk walk on a wintry day. But the brightness in her eyes was caused by tears, some of which had dripped onto her cheeks, and her lips quivered and then tightened as if she was struggling to contain her emotions. Pamela reached out and gathered her into a hug, resting her chin on the woolly cap that topped off Penny's ensemble. The officer watched, but didn't say anything. Pamela, nonetheless, felt bound to supply that she was Penny's mother. I was sketching, Mom, Penny said, her voice a bit muffled by the hug, and I came down here and followed that path, and she gulped, and a sob erupted. I'm Officer Anders, ma'am, the officer said, and I'll need your name. He was already holding a pen and a little notepad. Pamela Patterson, she answered, and gave her address for good measure. My daughter is home from college for the Christmas holidays. And I'm Wilfred Frasier, and this is my wife, Bettina Frasier. F-R-A-S-E-R, added a new voice, and Pamela felt a gentle hand on her shoulder. She released Penny, who looked slightly less stricken now that reinforcements had arrived. Wilfred had hurried into his jacket without bothering to remove his apron, but the apron didn't detract from the comfort offered by his bulky presence. Officer Anders bent to his notepad, but then looked up without writing. Nearby, a siren had been interrupted in mid-squeal, subsiding into a drawn-out moan. The police reinforcements had arrived. Bettina, meanwhile, had ventured a few steps in the direction of the bundled form, resting on the thick bed of brownish leaves that covered the ground.
"Oh, no!"
she exclaimed suddenly, whirling around.
"Wilfred! It's Millicent Farthingale!"
"Excuse me, ma'am?" Officer Anders had returned to his note-taking, but now looked up again. "Are you saying that you recognize the deceased?"
"It's my friend, Millicent Farthingale."
Bettina made a striking figure, with her vivid hair and her pumpkin-colored coat, her hazel eyes wide with alarm. "Are you sure, ma'am?" Officer Anders managed to look both quizzical and sympathetic. "The body is..." He waved uncertainly toward the bundled form. "You can hardly see.
That's her coat, and those are her boots, and that's her hair. She's blonde, though not naturally, of course. And she's small like that, slim, and not very tall."
Officer Anders nodded, and Bettina went on.
"I just saw her this morning at her shop. She owns..."
Bettina gulped.
"Owned?"
"A craft shop in Timberley." Officer Anders wrote furiously. Meanwhile, the officer who was kneeling by the body when they arrived had stood up. She positioned herself, the officer was a woman, as if standing guard over the person who had now been identified as Millicent Farthingale. The reinforcements, whose arrival the siren had announced, proved to be another uniformed officer and Arborville's lone police detective, Lucas Claiborne. He acknowledged Officer Anders with a curt greeting and directed a nod in the direction of Pamela, Penny, Bettina, and Wilfred. "We have an ID on the body, sir," Officer Anders said. "Miss Fraser recognized the woman as a friend of hers." He stared at his notepad. "Millicent Farthingale."
"Is that true?"
Detective Claiborne frowned at Bettina. His lived-in face was as nondescript as the dun-colored three-quarter-length coat he wore. Pamela thought he could have been a little more cordial, given that as chief reporter for Arborville's weekly paper, The Advocate, Bettina interviewed Detective Claiborne every few weeks for some article or another.
"Yes, yes,"
Bettina nodded vigorously.
"I was with her this morning. This is exactly what she had on, except..."
Bettina's eyes widened and she lifted a hand to her mouth.
"She was also wearing a scarf, a knitted scarf, red with green stripes at the ends."
Bettina's voice faltered and her brightly painted lips twisted. Wilfred had taken a few steps toward Bettina. Now he pulled her toward him.
"It was a beautiful scarf," he said.
I made the scarf," Bettina explained, "and I had just given it to her, and she liked it so much she put it on right then and there."
A large sob completed the sentence. Detective Claiborne's homely features rearranged themselves into a vaguely sympathetic expression.
"Officer Anders will take your statement," he said, "when you feel ready."
Officer Anders nodded. He was still holding his little notepad.
"And now,"
Detective Claiborne fixed his gaze on Penny,
"I understand it was you who found the body."
"Yes," Penny replied in a tiny voice, and Pamela rested a hand on the shoulder of the violet jacket.
"Your mother wasn't with you?"
The skin around his eyes tightened. Pamela recognized the look. Detective Claiborne could be more perceptive than his usual expression suggested. She knew why he'd asked the question. For such an idyllic little town, Arborville had a curiously high murder rate, and for some reason Pamela Patterson was often on the scene when a body was found.
"No," Penny said. "I'm home from college for Christmas. I'd gone out sketching." As if suddenly remembering something, she looked around and gestured toward a spiral-bound pad open to a graceful pencil sketch of bare trees with branches interlaced against the sky. "We don't live far, just across County Road and halfway up Orchard Street."
"I know where you live," Detective Claiborne said.
He pulled a notepad and pen from his coat pocket.
"Let's start at the beginning. Your full name, please?"
20 minutes later, Pamela, Penny, Bettina, and Wilfred were climbing into Wilfred's ancient Mercedes. As they pulled out of the clearing at the edge of the nature preserve, the huge silver van from the county sheriff's department arrived.
"It will all be in the register tomorrow," Bettina said.
"I'm glad we're getting away before that overly energetic register reporter shows up, or the radio and TV people."
"They'll find us, though." Pamela reached over to take Penny's hand.
"I'll have to write something for the Advocate," Bettina said from the front seat, swiveling around to face them. "I'll have to mention Penny."
Pamela nodded. "But you'll be talking to Detective Claiborne soon, and he'll know things. That was the crime scene unit arriving." Chapter 2.
"I suppose the police have contacted Pierre by now," Bettina said.
Instead of crossing the street to their own house when Wilfred steered the Mercedes into the Frasers' driveway, Pamela and Penny had accepted Bettina's invitation to join her and Wilfred for dinner. The sun had begun to set as Detective Claiborne and Officer Anders completed their interviews, and they'd been glad to escape the shadowy woods when Detective Claiborne told them they were free to go. Now it was nearly 6 p.m., and they were enjoying the familiar comfort of Bettina's kitchen. Pamela, Penny, and Bettina were sitting around the pine table, which had been cleared of cookies and cookie decorating supplies. Instead, it held a half-empty bottle and three glasses of red wine in various stages of consumption. Wilfred was across the room at the stove, the apron he'd neglected to remove for the trip to the nature preserve now serving the purpose for which it was intended. He was flourishing a long-handled wooden spoon over a gleaming stainless steel skillet, and the soothing aroma of onions sautéing in olive oil filled the room.
"Plenty of food for all of us," he assured them. "Braised chicken thighs with tomatoes, olives, and capers are just the thing on a dark and chilly night like this."
Bettina had been uncharacteristically silent. Her face looked drawn, and she stared gloomily at her wine glass, but she cheered slightly at Wilfred's announcement.
"Chicken is usually Tuesday night," she said. "Rotisserie chicken from the co-op. But with Wilfred retired now, we're eating like gourmets."
A willing but uninspired cook, Bettina had served her family the same 7 meals in regular rotation for most of her married life.
"How do you think Pierre will take the news?" Pamela asked. Bettina shrugged. "She was more in love than he was. Not that looks are everything."
Her gaze wandered toward the stove. Pamela agreed with the unspoken thought. Genial Wilfred, with his bear-like physique and ruddy cheeks, was truly a prize.
"Pierre will inherit, I suppose."
Pamela took a sip of her wine and glanced toward Penny's wine glass. Her daughter had taken scarcely a sip.
"No children. Millicent married late in life. I hope there's a will. She's leaving behind a considerable estate, including the Wentworth mansion. Millicent's mother grew up in that house, then moved back in when her parents died. Her mother wasn't well, and Millicent lived with her and took care of her. Then, when Millicent married Pierre, he moved in too. Lots of goodies for people to tussle over, and if that happens, the lawyers will get a good cut too," Bettina sighed. "It's just so sad. Nursing her mother all those years and looking after that huge house, and she was finally free and ready to downsize. Not that she wanted her mother to die, but I think the house is already on the market."
"Do you think Pierre will go ahead with the plans to sell?" Pamela had only met Millicent a few times, so the disposition of her estate wasn't of compelling interest. But talking about Millicent's house was at least a slight distraction from talking about her death.
Probably, Bettina said. A big house like that requires a lot of upkeep.
And even if there's plenty of money to pay for it, organizing the upkeep takes time. Not that Pierre has that many demands on his time. Pamela raised her brows.
I think you said once that he's a professor.
They work pretty hard, don't they?
Some do,
Penny commented with a slight laugh. Some don't.
Not exactly a professor, Bettina said. Part-time lecturer in French at Wendell Staff College, and not exactly French either. He's from Montreal.
The cheerful voice seemed out of place. Pamela had been struggling to complete a knitting project, a huge swath of fuzzy wool that was somehow to figure in a funeral service. But the voice was assuring her that the traffic was moving smoothly at the Hudson River crossings, including the upper deck of the George Washington Bridge. She opened her eyes to darkness. In the summer, the light coming through the white eyelet curtains at her bedroom window served as an alarm clock of sorts. In the winter, however, she had to rely on the clock radio. She rolled onto her back, stretched out an arm, and switched on the lamp on the bedside table. A soft form stirred at her feet, migrated up the side of her leg, and inched its way delicately across her torso. It eased its head out from under the down comforter that Pamela used on chilly winter nights. Two amber eyes stared at her from a heart-shaped face covered with silky jet-black fur.
Katrina, Pamela murmured. Good morning. Where are your children?
This pleasant daily ritual was interrupted by a forlorn voice coming from the hall.
Mom! Penny moaned. Someone's coming up on the porch, and I think it's reporters.
Katrina scrambled off the bed and hurried to the bedroom door. If someone was stirring, there would be breakfast soon. But Pamela's thoughts were less cheerful. It was barely 7 a.m. What nerve reporters had! She flung comforter and sheet aside, sat up and swung her feet to the floor and thrust them into her waiting slippers. A moment later, she had grabbed her robe and was hurrying down the stairs. She had just reached the landing when the doorbell chimed. She grabbed the railing to steady herself and continued her descent. The porch light revealed a perky young woman bundled in a neon green down coat with a fur-trimmed hood.
Marcy Brewer from the County Register, she announced, tilting her head to meet Pamela's eyes.
Despite her high-heeled boots, she was scarcely 5 feet tall, but her lipsticky smile and confident voice signaled that she was accustomed to getting her story.
Is Penny Patterson in?
Of course she's in, Pamela said, not bothering to soften the frown that she knew had furrowed her forehead and drawn her brows together.
It's 7 a.m., and she doesn't wish to speak to the press. She doesn't have to, you know.
Marcy Brewer's smile didn't waver. I take it you're her mother. Perhaps she'd like to answer for herself. Pamela willed herself to look fierce.
You're right. I am her mother, and I know what's best for her. Will she be having a follow-up interview with the police today?
The smile was still in place.
I expect so.
Pamela stepped away from the door and pushed it closed. In the kitchen, Penny had already set out a bowl containing several scoops of cat food. A black kitten was finishing his meal and Katrina joined her son. Penny was sitting at the table, still in her night clothes, a fleecy pink robe tugged on over flannel pajamas. Her dark curls were still tousled from bed. She held a cat on her lap, the ginger kitten Pamela had adopted from the litter of six Katrina had presented her with at the end of the previous summer.
She's getting used to me,
Penny said, running her fingers over the kitten's fur. She slept with me last night. The kitten's father was an impressive ginger Tom, and his three daughters had inherited his looks. Pamela had accordingly named the kitten Ginger, but being an avid cook, and with all three ginger kittens underfoot till recently, Pamela had decided the coats of supposedly ginger cats could be better described as pumpkin pie or butterscotch. You wouldn't have wanted to talk to Marcy Brewer from the county register, would you? Pamela asked. After she closed the door, she had realized maybe Penny was old enough to make such decisions for herself. What if something like this happened while she was at college? Pamela shuddered at the thought. Her mother wouldn't be there to protect her. No, Penny said. I'm glad you chased her away. Did you sleep all right? Pamela lowered herself into the chair across the table from Penny and studied her daughter's face. Penny's blue eyes were bright, but purplish shadows beneath them suggested her slumber had been less than restorative. I kept waking up, and then I'd see, she grimaced, and I kept wondering how she died. It wasn't obvious. She was just lying there. And the policeman led me away while the policewoman sort of studied the body. I guess they're not supposed to touch anything or move anything in case there are clues. That is, if they decide it's murder. But they must have, because then they called for more police. The fingers stroking the kitten's back began to move more rapidly. And that van came from the sheriff's department, Pamela supplied. Bettina will talk to Detective Claiborne, she added. Then we'll find out more from her. She stood up. But for now, how about some coffee and toast? Did you see the register out there when you opened the door? Penny asked. I'll get it now, Pamela said. At least if Marcy Brewer is gone. There was no reason, really, for Pamela to care if Richard Larkin saw her in her robe and slippers. The long fleece robe that reached nearly to the ground concealed more than a coat would. True, a fleece robe and furry slippers didn't constitute the most flattering of looks, but despite Bettina's urging to the contrary, Pamela refused to dwell on Richard Larkin's romantic potential. He was unattached and a suitable age and certainly attractive, but she preferred to consider him a neighbor with whom she had a cordial but detached relationship. Now he stepped away from the back of his olive-green Jeep Cherokee. He'd apparently just been loading something into the vehicle and caught sight of Pamela. He raised an arm in greeting and took several loping strides in her direction. He was wearing slim, dark pants and a bulky jacket, also dark. Despite the chilly morning, his shaggy blonde head was uncovered. Pamela had just stooped to retrieve the newspaper, and it was dangling from her hand in its flimsy plastic bag. Are you and Penny okay? Richard gestured toward the newspaper. It's been on the radio and TV, too, of course. His face could look so stern, with its strong features and deep eyes, but probably he didn't mean to look stern now. He was just concerned. We're fine, Pamela said, tilting her head back. Richard Larkin was very tall, and being tall herself, Pamela wasn't used to looking up at people. If there's anything I can do. He hovered there uncertainly, his eyes fixed on her face. Then he spoke in a sudden rush of words. I wish Lane and Sybil were here, he said, and his face relaxed, as if he was relieved to have found a conversational topic. It might help Penny to have her friends next door, but they're spending the Christmas break in San Francisco with their mother. I wish they were here, too, Pamela said. This is going to be hard. Well, if there's anything, he started to turn away. Thank you, Pamela said. She watched him lope back to his car. But she was not to return to her warm house quite yet. Bettina was waving from the end of her driveway. She waited while Richard Larkin backed out and headed up the street, and then she started across. I'm seeing Claiborne in an hour, she called before she reached the other side. The first item on his agenda. She joined Pamela at the end of Pamela's front walk. He's as anxious as I am to get the story into this week's Advocate. Even though Millicent lived in Timberley, it's Arborville's case because Arborville is where the body was found. Pamela tucked the register under her arm and hugged herself, rubbing her hands up and down the sleeves of her fleece robe. She was shivering. Her morning routine of fetching the register in robe and slippers usually just involved a quick dash out and back. Bettina was already dressed for the day, her pumpkin-colored down coat topping off burgundy slacks, complemented by sleek burgundy booties. She'd pulled a burgundy wool beret over her bright coiffure. She intercepted one of Pamela's hands to give it a squeeze. "Are you and Penny okay this morning?" she asked, tipping her head to examine Pamela's face. "Really weird dreams." Pamela smiled, a sad half-smile, as she recalled the hand-knit funeral shroud she'd been tasked with by her dreaming mind. "And Penny looks tired, but we'll be fine once we've had some coffee. Do you want to come in? I'm just going to make some." "I can't linger," Bettina released Pamela's hand. "I've got to stop by the advocate's office before I go to the police station." She turned toward the street, but then swung back. "That was nice of Richard to take the time for a little chat. Even from my yard, I could see he was concerned." "Any neighbor would be," Pamela said in a tone designed to discourage further development of that theme. Bettina got the message. "Well, then," she said, "I'll be on my way, but I'll be back with a report just as soon as I finish with Claiborne." She paused. "And don't forget Wilfred Jr. is dropping by this morning to pick up the black kitten for his sons." She turned back toward the street, but she didn't move, and neither did Pamela, at least for a minute. Heading toward them from the corner was a truck bearing the logo of the local TV station. "Oh, no," Pamela moaned. "I already chased away that Marcy Brewer from the register this morning. Now, them? I'll take care of it." Bettina tightened her lips into a stern line. A slight wrinkle appeared between her carefully shaped brows. "You get yourself into the house." Back inside and still bearing the plastic-wrapped register, Pamela watched through the lace that curtained the oval window in her front door as a young man and a young woman descended from the truck to be met at the curb by Bettina. The expressions on their faces suggested that they were very reluctant to abandon their assignment, but Bettina stood firm, and eventually they climbed back into their truck and went on their way. Penny had joined Pamela as she watched, now cuddling the black kitten against the pink fleece of her robe. "Wilfred Jr. is coming for that kitten this morning," Pamela said as they turned away from the window. She reached an arm around Penny's slim shoulders and gave her a squeeze. Back in the kitchen, Pamela deposited the register on the kitchen table. Its account of the body found in the Arborville Nature Preserve could wait until they had been fortified with coffee and whole grain toast. Accordingly, Pamela's next action was to measure water into the kettle and to set it boiling on the stove. Then she slipped a paper filter into the plastic cone balanced over the mouth of the carafe and scooped coffee beans into the chamber of her coffee grinder. The coffee-making ritual was detailed and time-consuming, but it was a ritual, and predictable rituals were soothing when events like that of the previous day reminded one how unpredictable life could be. With a clatter and a whir, the beans were ground, and the aroma of coffee began to infuse the kitchen. Pamela spooned the fragrant ground beans into the paper filter just as the kettle began to hoot, and soon the coffee aroma grew more intense as the boiling water dripped through the ground beans into the carafe beneath. Penny, meanwhile, had set down the black kitten, who had begun tussling in a half-hearted way with his bold sister, as if acknowledging that he was overmatched right from the start. Penny had taken cups and saucers from the cupboard, a pretty pattern featuring rose garlands. The cups and saucers were from Pamela's wedding china. She had resolved long ago to use her china every day, because what was the point of having nice things if they just sat in a cupboard except for a few days out of the year? As the coffee dripped, Pamela slid two slices of whole grain bread into the toaster. By the time the toast had popped up and was buttered, cut into neat quarters and set on the kitchen table, Penny had extracted the register from its plastic sleeve and unfolded it. Right there, on the front page, was the succinct headline, "Timberley Woman Found Dead in Arborville Nature Preserve." The thought of toast was suddenly not appealing, but Pamela fetched the carafe from the counter and filled each of the wedding china cups. The article talks about me, Penny said, looking up with a woeful expression on her pretty face. Police told reporters that the body was found by Penny Patterson of Arborville, who stated she was home from college for Christmas and had gone to the nature preserve on a sketching expedition. Pamela slipped around to Penny's side of the table and leaned over her shoulder to skim the article, waiting while Penny turned to an inner page for the continuation. A few sentences into the first paragraph on that page, Pamela heard herself gasp, and the sharp intake of breath was quickly echoed by Penny. "Someone shot her," Penny whispered. Pamela nodded. She quoted from the article. Police stated that the victim died from a gunshot wound to the chest. The medical examiner's report is expected to provide further information about the specific type of weapon used.
"I couldn't tell she'd been shot," Penny murmured near tears. "She was lying on her side, and her coat was kind of bunched up in front. Besides, I didn't really want to look."
She sniffed a huge sniff, and Pamela rested a hand on her back.
"I have to talk to the police again. 11 o'clock, they said, but I don't know what else I can tell them."
"They'll want to know if you saw anyone, I suppose, or any clue, like a car down by where the path leads in." Pamela had returned to the other side of the table. She reached over the newspaper to take Penny's hands.
"I'll come with you," she said. "Of course."
Penny sniffed again, but sat up straighter, suddenly resolute.
"It's okay, Mom," she said. "I can go by myself. I know where the police station is, but..."
Pamela felt her face pucker. "I'm your mother, and you're only..."
"I'm 19, Penny said, sitting up even straighter, "and I'm in college, on my own, all the way up in Massachusetts."
Pamela nodded. It was true. She'd been willing to let Penny go away for college because her own parents had let her go away for college, even though that meant she'd be all alone in her big house. But Penny hadn't inherited Pamela's height, taking after her father's side of the family instead. Pamela was a full head taller than her daughter. That made it especially hard for Pamela to rein in her protective impulses, especially because Pamela and Penny had been their own small family since Michael Patterson's death 6 years earlier. The two kittens had finished their tussle as Pamela and Penny talked and had wandered from the room. Pamela suspected that they had joined their mother on the thrift store Persian carpet in the entry, and that all three were luxuriating in the patch of morning sun that made the carpet's colors glow. The toast was cold, but they frugally ate it anyway, and they sipped reheated coffee as they browsed through the rest of the register. When the last drops of coffee had been drained from their cups, Penny stood. "You won't cancel Knit and Nibble tonight or anything, will you?" she asked, pausing near the tray of brightly decorated cookies covered with plastic wrap that waited on the counter.
"No," Pamela said, rising too. "We have to go on with our rituals."
Chapter 3. Upstairs, Pamela made her bed and arranged her collection of vintage lace pillows against the brass headboard. Then she dressed in her winter work-at-home uniform of jeans and a hand-knit sweater and stepped into the bathroom across the hall to run a comb through her dark, straight hair. Penny had inherited her curls from her father's side of the family. In her office, Pamela poked the buttons that would awaken her computer and listened through the beeps and hums that signaled it was preparing to face the day. 5 messages lurked in her inbox, 3 that could be dealt with later, and 2 from her boss at Fibercraft magazine. One of those was garnished with the stylized paperclip that indicated it brought with it attachments, i.e., work for Pamela. The other, at the top of the email queue, had been sent barely half an hour ago. With a click, it was open. "Pamela," the message began. Pamela's boss eschewed the nearly universal custom of opening every email with a casual hi, no matter how serious the import. But in this case, the formal greeting matched the seriousness of the message. "I've just heard the shocking news of Millicent Farthingale's death," the message went on. "This is a terrible blow to the fibercraft community. Millicent's shop was an important outlet for the work of tri-state textile artists, and I am not sure that her partner Nadine will be able to keep it going. In fact, I am quite sure that she will not. I know you are right there in Arborville, and so know more about the skill of local law enforcement, but I do not have high hopes that a suburban police force will be able to bring Millicent's killer to justice." Pamela took a moment to respond, keying in, "I'm sure they will do their best." The second email from her boss was more matter-of-fact. "Attached are 5 recent submissions to the magazine. Please read them and advise as to which you recommend for publication." The soothing rhythms of knitting were Pamela's first choice as an antidote for stress, but immersing herself in the worlds explored by the authors who submitted to Fibercraft came in as a close second. Now she clicked on the first attachment and prepared to evaluate recreating traditional Turkish weaving techniques. The second article was about jewelry made from the hair of dead people. Pamela fingered her chin as she skimmed the first paragraph. "It is true that hair is a fiber and making jewelry is a craft, but did the topic really fit the mission of Fibercraft? It seemed so. Macabre, particularly in light of Penny's grim discovery the previous day. But Pamela's boss must have seen the title, Memorializing the Departed, the Hair Art of Victorian Mourning Brooches, and skimmed the article before sending it on to Pamela for a more in-depth reading. She shrugged and began reading more closely. She'd barely read past the first paragraph when the doorbell chimed. Even from the landing, Pamela knew that her caller was Bettina, though veiled by the lace that covered the oval window in the front door. Bettina's pumpkin-colored coat stood out against the somber colors of the wintry landscape. Pamela hurried the rest of the way down the stairs and opened the door to greet her friend, who stepped inside murmuring about the cold wind. Once she was inside, she pulled off her beret and raised a hand to pat the tendrils of her vivid coif into place. Katrina looked up briefly from the sunny spot on the rug where she was still dozing. The kittens had long since wandered off. A few balls of leftover yarn had found new lives as cat toys, and the kittens often engaged in a morning game of capture the yarn ball. In fact, as Bettina slipped out of her coat, a ball of yarn rolled through the arch that separated the entry from the living room. Ginger followed in hot pursuit, trailed by her brother. Bettina had come in looking both eager and intense, as if bearing news that she could hardly wait to impart, but her face softened as she watched the kittens. "I hope Ginger won't miss her brother too much," she commented. "Katrina still likes to play." Pamela reached out a foot to send the ball of yarn bouncing back toward the living room. Ginger watched it as fixedly as her undomesticated forebears must have watched mice or birds they hoped to capture for lunch, and then she pounced and rolled onto her back, clinging to it delightedly. "I'd love some coffee," Bettina said, "and in return, I'll give you a full rundown on what Claiborne had to say. He knows more now than he did when he talked to that register reporter last evening. Lots more. I must say, the county medical examiner is very competent, but she's a woman, so, of course." Now that her coat was off, Bettina's whole outfit was revealed. The burgundy slacks and sleek burgundy booties were topped off by a cozy burgundy sweater, not hand-knit, she said, fingering it, and a paisley scarf in rich tones of burgundy, rust, and green. "I'm definitely ready for a coffee break myself." Pamela led the way to the kitchen and set to work boiling water and scooping more ground beans into a fresh paper filter. But Bettina hesitated before reaching down cups and saucers from the cupboard, or splashing heavy cream into the cut glass cream pitcher that matched Pamela's sugar bowl. She lingered by the tray of decorated cookies, their festive colors heightened by the shimmering plastic wrap that covered them.
"We probably don't need all of these for tonight, do we?" she said hopefully. "Nell is so suspicious of sugar, and Roland will say his doctor wouldn't approve, even though Roland is as skinny as a rail." Pamela turned and smiled fondly at her friend. "Yes," she said, "we can have cookies with our coffee." She opened a cupboard and took out a small plate garlanded with roses. "Put some on this." In a few minutes, they were seated with steaming cups of coffee in front of them, the rich and spicy aroma promising a perfect complement to the Santas and reindeer waiting to be nibbled. Bettina bit off a Santa head. She took a sip of the coffee that she had sugared liberally and diluted with cream until the color was more coffee ice cream than coffee. Then she began to speak. "Millicent had been dead about 6 hours when Penny found her," Bettina said, the Santa body still in her hand. "Claiborne said the M.E. is pretty sure of that. They have ways of knowing. So that means she was killed not very long after I saw her at her shop. She was getting ready to go out while you were there. But she was still in the shop when you left." Pamela reached for a cookie, choosing a reindeer. She set the reindeer by her saucer and raised her coffee to her lips. "That's right," Bettina said. "Nadine had just come in. Millicent had been waiting for her because she couldn't go out and leave nobody there to look after things, but she was all ready. The scarf looked so nice with her coat." "The body wasn't wearing a red scarf with green stripes," Pamela said. Bettina shook her head mournfully. "I wonder where the scarf is now." Bettina continued to shake her head. "Anyway," Pamela said, "did Millicent say where she was going?" Bettina shrugged. "Just errands. But since we were both heading out, I asked if I should wait a few minutes and we'd walk to our cars together. But she had to explain something to Nadine, something about preparing checks for the people who sell their work through the shop, Christmas and all, and people like extra money for holiday expenses." Bettina bit the Santa body in half. "Millicent had no head for money, but Nadine can be a little slow on the uptake, so Millicent said I should just go on and she'd talk to me later." Bettina polished off the Santa body and reached for another cookie. Pamela noticed that even her nails carried out the burgundy theme today. "So," Pamela said, "Millicent was killed yesterday morning. I suppose the police are searching that clearing in the nature preserve for clues." "Well, they did already," Bettina said. "They didn't find much of anything, but they realized she wasn't actually killed there." "She wasn't?" Pamela set her cup back down on her saucer with a clunk. "A secluded place like that? It seemed just right if somebody wanted to commit a murder and get away with it." She paused, blinked, frowned, and thought for a minute. Then she added, "Of course the killer would have had to lure her there with some sort of a story, and it's hard to imagine what that story might have been." Bettina nodded. "Millicent wasn't really the outdoorsy type." "So what do the police think happened?" Pamela picked up the reindeer cookie and bit it in half. "She was killed somewhere else, and then the killer dumped the body there." Bettina took a sip of coffee. "The police could see by the way the dead leaves were disturbed that the body had been dragged from that parking area, and they didn't find any evidence that a gun had been fired in the clearing. But," Bettina took another sip of coffee, "the M.E. recovered a bullet from her body." She smiled. The first Pamela had seen her smile since she'd fielded the call from Penny the previous afternoon. "That's a big clue," Bettina said. "Sometimes bullets go right through and the police never find them, but now they know something about what kind of gun it was." "A rifle," Claiborne said, "like an old hunting rifle. And the bullet was lead. Solid lead. That means it could have been homemade." "People make their own bullets?" Pamela shuddered. "Oh, how creepy." "Hunters," Claiborne said. "The rifle could belong to some kind of hunter, or somebody who knows a hunter could have had access to it." Pamela shuddered again.
Did you tell him about the man who'd upset her that morning?
I did.
Bettina bit into her second cookie, another Santa. He was interested, like the only lead they really have. He said he'd follow up with Nadine, even though I clearly told him that Nadine wasn't in the shop yet when the man came. Maybe that wasn't the first time the man had been there. Bettina studied the half-Santa in her hand.
I think this is one of Wilfred's, she said. He was so careful getting the red suit.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.